how do we look at information in a different way that we can make things more useful? What's important out of this activity? Why am I doing it? You know, how am I going to leverage things? Because at the end of the day, we all want to do it faster, we want to do it better, and we want to do it cheaper. The majority of my presentation is going to end up being what I call a step-by-step DFR example. So all of it is going to end up taking a product that we want to design. We'll start out at the concept phase, go through the entire product development phase, and look at what are the things that I need to be doing as a reliability engineer, and what are the activities I need to be doing, and how do I leverage them from step to step. So pretty much most of it is going to be an example-based approach. So one of the things that when I talk about reliability, just wanted to take a fun 10 minutes and do a little bit of a quick history tour. What was the earliest reference, if you go back to history, that you can find that talks about something related to reliability? So about as early back as I could go is down to about 1772 BC, Code of Hammurabi. I'd call that basically motivation. So we'll start out with that as an early motivation. As you move through history, there's a poem by Oliver Wendell Holmes called The Deacon's Masterpiece. I don't know if anybody's ever read it or seen it. Talks about a one-horse shay, which is a one-horse carriage. And basically, it's a fairly long poem. It's satirical poetry, but it breaks down and so forth. But if you start going through the verses in the poem, you start kind of realizing that a lot of the stuff in there is pretty much what we do in reliability today. And then again, we're talking about 1800s. And one of the things that comes up front is that built it in such a logical way that it can run 100 years today. Pretty much what we call design for reliability. You start going down later and then you see there's always a weakest spot. You know, you gotta find that weakest spot, and if you don't find that weakest spot, then that's how it fails and doesn't wear out. Our objective is to make it wear out and last long enough. Again, FMEA is reliability testing, HALT. Kind of continues through different phases. There's always a weakest place, and you gotta find that. Because if you don't find that, again, that's what's gonna cause your failure. Stress-strength analysis. Heading to the 1945, ENIAC 1. First computer, first modern computer put together. Didn't do much than an old calculator at that time. However, it did weigh in at 27 tons and had about 17,000 vacuum tubes, bunch of diodes, 5 million hand-soldered joints. And one of the interesting points, and it was first proposed and it was first put together, a bunch of people jumped up and said that this thing's not going to work long enough to do anything useful. And it wouldn't work long enough from a reliability perspective to get any calculations done. And they were pretty much correct. Moving forward, just for fun, I said, hey, if they were all in series and they had a constant failure rate, they don't, we all know that. But just for fun, if we assume that those tubes had a constant failure rate, all in series, and at about 17,500 of them, what would your reliability be for, let's say, 24 hours? About 62%. Now, moving forward, you start looking at, the reason I brought up the computer, is we start putting together more complex systems, 1940s, 1950s, most of them coming out of DOD, Department of Defense. So you start seeing some of the early papers, some of the early standards put together on reliability. That's what I would term as reliability 1.0. As a matter of fact, if you go back to 1949, US Army MIL P1629 gets published. And that talks about failure modes, effects, and criticality analysis. As you go through that 1950s, see different papers, different work, Weibull's and Audubon work that comes out about at that time. Then we move into the space program. As we move into the space program, reliability again becomes fairly important. You pull out a standard that tells you how to do failure modes, effects, and criticality analysis, published by NASA for the Apollo program in 1966. Matter of fact, as you move forward, we start again doing more things in reliability, and if I stick with the same standard, 1977, you'll see the same one published again, Milstat 1629A, which is pretty much the most current of all of them out there on FMECAs. You know what's the difference between that, the NASA document and the Army document? They got different cover pages. Pretty much the contents are the same. Actually, this one I think has got better typesetting. But other than that, pretty much we followed down the same line. So a lot of the procedures got put together in 1940s, 1950s, 60s, even early 70s. You see a lot of the early work, a lot of the procedures being put together. Pretty much all of them up to this time being the domain of the DoD or some government agency, i.e. the space program. As we move into the 80s, interesting thing happens, and for those of you that happen to remember, Japanese are basically coming in and scaring the heck out of Detroit, and at that point, taking a lot of market share out of the big three. And a lot of has to do with reliability, you know, truth be told. And again, I don't know how many of you remember cars in the 80s, but they were pieces of junk from a reliability perspective. And we've reached a point that things needed to change. So you see a lot of it coming, a lot of reliability now coming into focus, middle 80s, late 80s, early 90s, from a lot of your automotive industries. Interestingly also, if you start looking at ads about the same era, we're actually advertising about reliability. You don't see much of that today, but you open a magazine, you just see the word reliability kind of stuck in different places, depending what car you're gonna buy. Because again, it did take a level of importance. Now, after the automotive, as you're into the 90s and getting into today, pretty much most industries start adopting reliability policies or principles. So you start seeing quite a bit of it kind of evolve and get us to where it gets us today. I call it reliability 2.0. So each activity is now being performed, in my mind, up to a level where I think we need to be doing it. And again, that doesn't give us much room to kind of go forward. So we've done an excellent job from an activity perspective. And one of the things about perfecting individual activities, you tend to make experts in a certain area, which is a good thing. You've got your WIBOL experts, you've got your HALT experts, you've got your DOE experts. So as we get those expertise, we started diverging and kind of creating silos. We've ended up segmenting a lot of our activities, and again, put them into different silos, and we're failing at this point to actually communicate between those. In other words, we kind of want to break those silos. In doing so, a lot of our thinking needs to change a little bit. Okay, again, even though we may have perfected the activities, sometimes we get stuck on thinking about certain things in a certain way. On top of that, there's a couple of other things that we need to rethink when it comes to our activities. Okay, what are the things we need to rethink? Again, I'll pick one activity per se, and let's pick out the FMEA. We've all usually, in every room I sit in there, everybody's done at least an FMEA in their life, if they call themselves a reliability engineer. If I go back to 1949, first standard was put together, what was the best way to capture information at that time? On a printed piece of paper? How else did you share information in the 50s, 60s, and 70s? Through documents, right? Let's fast forward, 2013. What's the best way to share information? Digitally. Okay, isn't the digital format a much better way to share information? We had a lot more information to deal with. Now, this served us very well when basically the most advanced tool at our disposal was an IBM Selectric. Okay, and for those of you that wonder why there's 8 columns in there instead of 9, well, you got tab columns on the typewriter. You got 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper. That's how many columns you're gonna put on there. Now, computer people, including us, didn't make things any better. When you start putting FMEA software together, the original ones that come out in the 90s, basically what you end up doing is you're taking that paper format and I'm giving you a computer to replace the typewriter. Okay, in other words, I'm still kind of stuck with that format. My objective is to generate that pretty piece of paper. Speaking about this, as we got to a computer, really, that gave us the ability to generate lots and lots of pieces of paper, a lot easier. Saved a bunch on whiteout, okay? But if I give you documents, if I give you a very large system and start giving you FMEAs up to here, how useful are they? We need to look at them and not look at each activity and rethink what we do in reliability engineering in a way that we're maximizing our efficiency, we're using what we do, and we're using that in a process.
And I will talk to you. I will recite for you some lines from Shakespeare's Hamlet.
Thought.
She selects a trunk and key pulses the number.
Take up your receiver and listen for the dial tone. If you don't hear the dial tone within a reasonable time, hang up. Wait a few seconds and then try again.
Before placing or receiving a call, power must be on. The phone unlocked.
Now, bottom line is we've all got phones. How many of you actually use your phone anymore? You've all got a fancy phone, I assume. How many of you use it to make phone calls? Or how much time of it do you use it to make? I shouldn't say, we use it to make phone calls, but is that the major use of it? No. Okay, there's a lot of other things you tend to do with your phone today that you never did with your old rotary dial. That's the point I'm looking at. We've got procedures. We've got ways to do that. We've got tools that evolved over the years, but yet we haven't stepped back and looked at the paradigm shift. How do we look at information in a different way that we can make things more useful? Simple way to do that, I said, there is, I'm gonna call them activities, generic activities. And again, most of the stuff we do today, I mean, from your viable analysis, life data analysis, prediction, stress strain, physics of failures, your fracas, your warranty analysis, root cause analysis, your process of FMEAs, your RCMs, your regular FMEAs, your RBDs, fault trees, reliability, growth, all of those are activities. Okay, some of us, probably not everybody here does every single one of them, but we do most of them. Problem is, again, each one of those is done on its own without really looking at the other ones. And what I wanted to point out is that instead of looking at each one of them, let me just go ahead and put them in a pie. And let's call that a reliability engineering analysis activity pie. And within that pie, I'll create a group called procedural inductive analysis. I'll put on your RCMs, your FMEAs, other activities in that piece of the pie. I'll group all of my analysis procedures over here, say data analysis modeling, that would be my viable accelerated testing. I'll get over to your system analysis. I'll put your RBDs, your fault trees, simulations, whatever you do in that piece of the pie. Physics of failure, prediction, those type of activities, I'll put them in there because they have a lot of things in common. Fracas, root cause analysis, failure reporting, I'll put it in there. And you want to ask that question. What in this activity could be useful to another activity? So put a list of all the activities and then start saying what is useful, what information would another activity be able to leverage out of this? Okay, if you do that, you're going to start finding out you got lots and lots of connections. But if I'm doing, let's say, procedural inductive and I'm doing an FMEA, I'll put it in this group. Is that information useful to anybody else? Heck yeah, to everybody there. Okay, there is stuff I could share with a guy doing a system analysis and modeling that needs to know that. A guy trying to design an accelerator test needs to know that information. If I build a model, let's say I build a Weibull up there, that explains to me how a bulb fails or a failure mode happens. Okay, so let's say I've got a model that describes the failure mode of filament burn on an incandescent light bulb. Is that information useful? Yeah, these guys need it. If I'm doing an FMEA where I got occurrence, why can't I use that? Find out what that value is. Isn't that useful over there? If I've got root cause analysis over here and I've got failure reporting, That information is useful there. That information is useful over there, and so forth. So as you go through that, you start finding out that there's lots and lots of connections. It is plain and simple that every activity can leverage information from another activity, and it could also provide information to another activity. So now, everything is kind of interconnected. Okay. Now, if I can start leveraging activities, means I'm doing less, right, time-wise. So that becomes faster. I'm also going to show you how it actually becomes better. It's one of those situations that by leveraging information from multiple disciplines, you're actually getting better information. So you're only doing it quicker, you're doing it better. That to me is where I think we need to be moving to from a reliability perspective. As I said earlier, in 1.0 we invented the stuff. We came up with all the processes. 2.0 we perfected the activities. Well, the next evolutionary step that we need to move to is start leveraging and interconnecting those activities instead of treating them as independent activities. As an example, I do two activities. If I do a design FMEA, and then my next activity is to come up with a baseline reliability modeling, most of the time today, I tend to do those two activities independent from each other. If I could combine them into one activity, I would end up saving time. Fair statement? And again, time is money. Okay, so I'm quicker to finish a set of activities than one of them. So with that said, up to this point, I think I've illustrated, you know, what we need to do and why we need to kind of look at it this way. And I think the what and the why is fairly self-explanatory. It gets complicated when you start thinking about the how. We've got different people, or we've got different expertise, if you want to put it that way, at each one of those levels. Each group of expertise tends to speak a slightly different language or kind of look at things from a different perspective. Now, if I want to share things across everybody, the challenge becomes is that if I'm going to provide you information that you need to use, you need to understand that information. For you to understand that information, you need to have certain expertise on the subject that you're receiving information from. Which brings up the next issue where nobody's an expert on everything, and nobody will ever be an expert on everything. Okay, so now how do I make everybody or assume everybody's an expert on every activity so they can leverage that information? That's the challenge that you start getting into it. In absence of that, you need some kind of a referee or a universal translator sitting in the middle to kind of be able to provide that information in a way that is useful to somebody. As an example, let's say I've got a guy that's spent many, many years doing accelerated testing. And let's say I've got my ALDA expert that did an accelerated test on a specific failure mode on that bulb. Now I've got these guys over here that don't know how to spell accelerated testing, and they're doing my FMEA, and they've got a filament burn on their bulb. And instead of guessing at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 what the occurrence is, I want to actually use a real number, right? Now, for me to use a real number, I need to go get this model and stick it in there, right? But then I got to understand how I use that. And if these guys have no idea what that is, how do I get that information over without making the expert sit with them? That's one of the challenges you start getting into when you run into the house. And again, how do you do it for a very complex system with lots and lots of activities? And how do I get the whole team to communicate? So what we need to do is kind of come up with a way to take that complexity away. And that brings up the next part of what I want to introduce, and I'm going to end up using as I go through this, is what you do is you start looking at what other industries have done and what's out there that we could use from a concept perspective to kind of take us from point A to point B or address this particular item. If you go back to software, object-oriented programming, what really that does, takes a piece of code, encapsulates it into something, and allows people to use it without really caring what's inside that particular code. Now, what if we took that and kind of looked at what we do in reliability engineering and kind of converted it into more of an object-oriented analysis rather than the way we're doing it today? And this is where the hows come in, and it's really mostly the mechanics as to how you end up doing it. What you really want to do is establish a universal set of data information that you can update constantly, and you can have multiple people use it. Okay. In doing so, you want to maintain some rules and structure, but at the same time, you don't necessarily want to make everybody an expert on it. So when you start thinking about it, and you spend lots and lots of time thinking, how do I do that? It really comes up that, what if I started thinking of everything I do in reliability engineering modeling, think of it more as an object-oriented approach, and think of all the analysis as an object that I could share with somebody else. What do I mean by that? Well, let's step back. Let's take something very simple. So I do a Weibull plot. I got data, fit a Weibull model on it, I get a plot, right? What am I doing? What is the outcome of that exercise? Again, from a 10,000 foot level. It's a model, right? All I'm doing is giving you a model that you can ask it whatever you want to ask it. You want to ask it what the B10 life is? You go in and say, oh, based on this Weibull analysis, the B10 life is this. Okay, mean time to failure is this. So all of our reliability questions that we may have can be answered by the model once I do my analysis. But then I can go to other types of analysis. I can get into accelerated life testing. What am I doing when I get there? It's the same thing. I basically take data, now it requires another set of expertise, and once I have those expertise, I end up building a model, right? And then once I build that model, somebody else can use it without really understanding how I created it, so I'm encapsulating that complexity. I go to degradation analysis. Same thing. Pretty much any type of analysis we do, statistical analysis and model building, I can reduce all of them into a model that I could give somebody to use without understanding the complexity. Furthermore, without even them caring what analysis originated it. So going back to my Weibull analysis, one of the things that we kind of said how we want to do things is start looking at it where I can take that widget, put it in a box, create a model, then share it with whoever I want to. Reasonable? So as an example, say I've got a widget, and what I want to do is build a model of the widget and let other people use it. So if I want to do it from a Weibull analysis, what I would end up doing, again, I do the same steps I do today. My Weibull analyst will go in there and say, get their times to failure, 10, 20, 30, 40, whatever the numbers happen to be. I'll build my model. And as I build my model, one of the things I could do is go publish it. Let's say now, let's create an object out of this that I'm going to call my widget. Now, that goes up in the cloud, and it kind of sits there. And I can still do what I want to. I can come up with whatever metrics I do in my analysis. But somebody else sitting somewhere else wants to do a reliability block diagram. What he can do is go in there and say, you know what? I'm using a widget. I'm going to go to the library, grab a widget, put it in there, and then he brings in all the information I need for that widget. I'm doing an FMEA, I could do the same thing. If I want to do an RCM or an FMEA analysis, I could go through and, again, pull out that widget, and with it, it'll bring whatever properties that widget had, regardless where it was created. And at the same time, if I change anything later on, if the guy that owns the widget changes any attributes of that, or I got more data that come in over time, by changing the attributes of my widgets, I pretty much change everybody else in hiring my widget and update all of their analysis. Now, at the end of the day, one of the most simplest object models you can use is start encapsulating your analysis. So I could look at a model object of something that encapsulates my analysis as I move forward. So what it would have, well, it'd be linked to a data source, really where did it come from or an analysis method. And then, how do I use it? It's by using different methods, you know, different ways to query it for different results. Then other stuff that come in very useful, especially once you start getting into this type of an analysis, is metadata. In other words, labels, categories, especially if you've got thousands and thousands of them. How do I find them? How do I know what something is? So then it becomes a whole other job of categorizing things and providing the right information to make them useful. But at the end of the day, even at the model level, I could have all of them. I could have a giant warehouse automatically as I do my analysis, if I choose to do it this way, that ends up storing pretty much every component I have or every item I have for me to use later. Now, that's a basic model. I can make it more complicated. To be able to build a complex system, I can't just rely on simple models. I got to have a higher complexity on models, right? So again, if you look at object orientation, one of the things you can do is kind of create more complicated models from existing models. Let's say if I got a Y-ball that my widget's got two failure modes, A and B. I've got a Y-ball, let's say, that describes how failure mode A happens and how failure mode B happens. But I don't want to expose that to the world. What I want to give everybody is failure model for the widget itself. Then I can combine those two and expose a higher level object that combines A and B. Or I could go in there and say, okay, I've got an RBD that I can get an equation out for that. So each one of those being a model. But at the end of the day, I can take all of that and expose it to somebody as just an object C. They don't need to know any of that. So that gives me an unlimited level of complexity as I move forward to build fairly large and complex systems. So by itself, depending on the context that they're used, they know exactly how they interface with whatever activity is using them. Because it's pretty well predefined. Make sense? If I drop in a distribution into a time to repair field, what is it going to get out of it? It's going to give you a random variable. That's your time to repair. It kind of knows within that context, that's what I'm supposed to give out as an answer. And then you can add higher levels. I mean, if you're looking at maintenance, I don't only care how something fails. I'm going to look at how to repair it. How long does it take to repair it? How much money? Who's going to do it? Where do I find the part? And I can start creating objects of everything. At the end, I can start relating them with a much higher level object. I'm going to call that a URD, Universal Reliability Definition. We'd end up having all my costs, my parts, my crews, everything I need to. So I can conceptually grab that part, drop it somewhere, and it'll have all the information I'm looking for without me having to go find it, recreate it. That now makes life a heck of a lot easier because at the end of the day, a single widget may end up having hundreds or even thousands of models associated with it. But again, if you're managing it this way, it becomes a lot more manageable than in any other way. So an example, if I take that widget, let's say that widget has a red part, a blue part, and an orange part. And let's say my red part's got two failure modes, red one, red two, and so forth. Each one of those may have an object that describes how I fail, who repairs me, how long it takes to repair me, what are my costs, and so forth. So all of that information could be associated with that, and obviously may have different ones for each one of those. Now the beauty of this is that, let's say I've got a repair duration model that I'm associating with this. It's somewhere up there that then talks to the how long the crew takes to do it and so forth. Now I've got the guy in the field where I'm getting real data from my CMMS system in the field. Okay, I can go in and just change that because I'm the expert at that. I know how long it takes me. And then automatically anybody else in the entire company that's using me gets updated with the latest information. Does that make sense? So in this scenario, again, I'll just say, hey, I'm going to go up and take that and change that to a more realistic model that came out of real data at a later point in time. Now once that happens, that changes. And again, if my results of interest is some availability or cost, what I would do is start dropping down and everything else that's related with that changes. And as that moves forward, it updates all of my results. Again, it gives you, it's a simplicity through complexity is what it comes down to.